Hi, I'm Mike Watkins, director of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory here in Pasadena, California. Behind me is what we call the center of the universe. It's our Deep Space Mission Control Center, and it's where we talk to spacecraft far beyond Earth's orbit. It's been staffed 24/7, 365 days a year since 1964, and it's been home to many of the critical moments in the history of planetary exploration, and virtually every picture you've ever seen from another planet has come through this room. Here, the engineers are constantly transmitting and receiving signals through the Deep Space Network, or the DSN as we call it. The DSN is the primary way we send signals from here all the way to here. For the next several minutes, in our spacecraft, specially imagined for South by Southwest, I'll be taking you on a journey to some of our most important missions and recent discoveries in the exciting search for life in the universe. Each of us has looked up in the night sky and wondered, are we alone, or does one of those points of light harbor life? Now, for the first time, JPL is tantalizingly close to answering that question. Let's look at one of the closest points of light in the night sky, the planet Mars. For hundreds of years, we've been imagining Mars as a place full of life, friendly or not so much. But when we first visited Mars with spacecraft, it looked cold, dry, and quite lonely. We even landed on Mars in 1976 to test the soil for signs of current life.
366 feet, 73 feet per second. ACS is close to vertical.
So we're coming down, straight down.
Nav is green for touchdown. ACS is green, 1.5 degrees per second max, 0.2 Gs.
8 feet per second.
Touchdown, we have touchdown.
An incredible engineering challenge for 1976, but it's generally accepted that the experiments came up negative. Over the years, scientists digested data from our detailed orbital views of Mars and started to form a hypothesis. Mars apparently used to be more habitable, warmer, wetter, a denser atmosphere, and over time grew colder and drier, and is no longer habitable, at least at the surface we can easily access. So we realized we need to visit the parts of Mars that are the oldest in order to understand what ancient Mars was really like. First with Spirit and Opportunity, and then through Phoenix, and especially Curiosity, we found remnants of ancient Mars that definitely showed us Mars was once habitable. In fact, Mars was probably a blue planet 3 or 4 billion years ago, with oceans, rivers, and even a lake, which Curiosity was able to tell us once held drinkable water. And we found, and are still searching further, for signs of organic molecules that scientists associate with life. We learned two key lessons from Curiosity. The first is that where you land and explore are critical. You have to go to the places that preserve remnants of those ancient days, 3.5 billion years ago, when Mars was habitable. Secondly, we will always be limited in the amount of scientific equipment we can take to the surface of Mars, especially when it comes to looking for things as subtle as signs of ancient life. So the scientists and NASA made a decision. Let's go to the best site on Mars that preserves signs of that ancient habitability. Collect samples from around that area and then bring them back to the Earth, where the most sophisticated analysis laboratories on the planet can analyze those samples for signs of ancient life. We call this the Mars Sample Return Campaign. And it starts with the Perseverance rover, which landed on Mars on February 18th. Let's take a closer look at what it took to design, build, and operate a robotic explorer and astrobiologist that will collect those samples. The drill and other components are critical to the sampling system. These are the scientific instruments mounted on the mast and on the arm being installed. Finishing up the mobility system leads to the rover's first drive and final system tests. Over 1,000 JPLers have been responsible for getting Perseverance to the surface of Mars. This is actual footage we received during Perseverance's entry, descent, and landing, and captured for the first time in breathtaking detail. You can see everything from the inflation of the supersonic parachute that opens in less than 1 second, to the descent stage, lowering the rover onto the surface of Mars. And then the rover looking back at the descent stage as it flies away.
Tango Delta.
Touchdown confirmed.
For the first time, we can now all share the experience of landing on Mars. Perseverance has landed in Jezero Crater, an ancient lake bed and delta, the first choice for Mars scientists. It will be able to rove across the area, letting the team select the best spots to collect samples. The sampling system is one of the most complex mechanical robotic systems ever sent into space, with the ability to core into rock, move that sample into an individual storage tube, and then seal that tube and move on to the next sample. Of course, all this hardware also had to be painstakingly cleaned and handled during final assembly so that the fewest possible Earth organics are present. We want to find ancient Mars life, not refined Earth life. Perseverance will collect a few dozen samples for later return to the Earth. In order to help the team select the best samples, the rover also carries a number of sophisticated cameras along with instruments to measure the composition of rocks and soil. In 2026, we intend to launch another mission to go and retrieve these samples. This mission, called the Sample Retrieval Lander, will carry a small rover able to drive over to the Perseverance samples and pick them up. And if Perseverance is still working fine, which I expect, she can also drive over to us and drop off the samples, which the lander then puts into a special container. Then, in a planetary exploration first, the sample container is loaded into a rocket on the lander and launched from the surface of Mars into Mars orbit. There, in orbit around Mars, another spacecraft, currently in design by the European Space Agency, will rendezvous and capture the sample container and load it into an aerodynamic entry vehicle and return it to the Earth, where the samples will safely land at the Utah Test and Training Range, completing the Mars sample return mission and humanity's first round trip of samples from another planet. But Mars isn't the only place in the solar system that may have once been or even still be habitable. Let's turn our attention to the ocean worlds of the outer solar system. Most of us, including scientists, thought of the Earth not just as an ocean planet, but as the ocean planet, and that closer to the sun, it's too hot for liquid water, and farther away, it's too cold. But shockingly, starting really just in the last 20 years, we've realized there are places in the outer solar system where conditions do allow liquid water to exist in a stable way. Let's look at a moon of Jupiter called Europa. It's actually about the size of our own moon and completely ice covered with virtually no atmosphere. It orbits Jupiter every 3.5 days in a not quite circular orbit. And that tiny eccentricity causes Europa to stretch a little and back as it goes around Jupiter, just like the tides here on the Earth. That tidal stretching back and forth actually heats up the inside of Europa and melts the ice, so that we are now almost certain there is an ocean under the surface ice cap. The ice cap may be tens of miles thick, but the ocean could be 100 miles deep. And in fact, Europa's ocean probably contains more water than all of the Earth's oceans combined. It's also looking very likely that the water from that ocean makes its way up through cracks in the ice, and possibly even geysers up at times. Because the surface is fairly young, you notice it doesn't have the craters you might expect, because the surface keeps getting renewed with water and then refreezing. Scientists realize there is one place we know with a water ocean. That's here on Earth. And we have life. So that's why Europa could be the next best candidate for life. And not just ancient life, maybe even existing life. So NASA created the Europa Clipper mission, currently set to launch in 2024. Clipper will fly over Europa dozens of times, conducting remote sensing of the ice composition, looking for warmer spots where there could be thinner ice or geysers, measuring the particles around Europa, and using an ice-penetrating radar to study the structure of the ice and measure its depth. Clipper is one of the largest and most complex robotic spacecraft ever built. And just to give you a sense of scale, its solar panels are the size of a basketball court. If Clipper confirms that Europa is indeed a candidate for habitability, we are already planning a lander that could directly sample the ice on the surface and examine it for signs of life. And even early technologies for a mission that could drill through the ice and explore the ocean via submarine. But there may also be an easier way to get to an outer planet ocean. Europa is not the only moon with an ice-covered water ocean. Saturn's moon Enceladus actually has active geysers, and they've been photographed by the Cassini spacecraft during its decade-long mission at Saturn. That same tidal force that heats up the ice also cracks it, allowing it to form these geyser-like sprays. JPL and NASA are actively working on missions to fly directly through the geysers, analyzing the water droplets. JPL has designed the world's most advanced miniaturized life detection suite that combines microscopes, electrophoresis, and other techniques into a tiny package that robots could take into the ocean worlds. One concept we have is called eels, which we envision to look something like this, which is a swimming robot that perhaps we could maneuver through a crevasse and into the ocean on Enceladus, where it could search for signs of life in that ocean. So far in this talk, we've focused on our own solar system. But in an astonishing set of discoveries, almost entirely in the last 10 years, the latest space-borne and ground-based observations have shown us that almost every star we look at carefully has planetary companions. In fact, there are probably more planets than stars. And that gives us billions more chances that one of them has life. We are close to having the technology to make that discovery. Welcome to JPL and NASA's Exoplanet program. How do you observe an exoplanet? At present, you essentially look for the gravitational effect on its host star, the tiny tugs that change its position. Or you look for a tiny bit of dimming of the star as the exoplanet passes between us and the star and blocks a bit of the light. Using these techniques, we've found thousands of exoplanets, some as potentially close as our nearest neighbor, 4 light years away at Proxima Centauri, and some vastly farther away. But why don't we look at the exoplanets directly instead of just their effect on the host star? Well, the reason is that we only want to look at the light that is reflected off the exoplanet and not the light coming directly from the star. And it turns out that the light from the exoplanet is less than 1/1,000,000,000 of the light coming directly from the star. So we need to block out that light like the sun visor in your car. And JPL is developing exactly those technologies. And that should allow us to directly image the exoplanets. The first is called a coronagraph. And it works by putting a special dot on the optics of a spaceborne telescope. We essentially point the telescope at the star and line up the dot to mask out the star. In fact, we call the dot a mask. And then with that light mostly blocked, we try to reconstruct the image of the exoplanet. As you can imagine, there is a huge amount of engineering to do this. But we are actually building this instrument now to fly on the Nancy Grace Roman telescope, currently planned for launch in 2025. We are also working on a concept in which the mask is not on the optics, but actually is a separate spacecraft. We position that spacecraft out in front of the telescope, and the spacecraft blocks the light from the central star. And again, we try to reconstruct the image of the exoplanets. We call this a starshade. One of the biggest challenges is how to fold up such a large structure into the launch vehicle so we can get it into space. And the designers have drawn inspiration from the ancient art of origami. Each of these techniques has pros and cons, and we are working both to determine the best ways to use each. And we have another goal in mind. Some of the light from the distant star passes through the atmosphere of the exoplanet. And when light passes through gas, some parts of the light are absorbed by the gas. Think of it like some of the colors of the rainbow are absorbed and not present when we receive the light. The parts that are removed are very sensitive to the composition of the atmosphere. So that means we can someday look at individual planets and tell whether their atmosphere has oxygen and water and could be Earth 2.0. Perhaps with sufficient data, we could even determine if the atmosphere is being affected by life as it modifies the expected chemistry. I hope today's talk has given you an idea of the incredible progress being made at JPL and NASA in the search for life. It's a wonderful time to be part of that journey as we take the next important steps. Will life be found here in our own solar system or orbiting a distant star? Come with us and let's find out together.